topic, Dira. Dira is, I think she'll be elaborating at how important it is. Over to you, Dr. Shantakumari.
Thank you, Dr. Fessy and Dr. Kunjumoidin. It's indeed a pleasure to be here with you all. And I've seen the wonderful work you have done for women's health. You're a small society, but I think you have been more productive than many of the bigger society, than many of us have done. You know, the way you have adopted the tribal villages, the way you have seen that the girls there are empowered. See, one of your girls have gone up to civil services, something which is fantastic. So I'm really happy that your society is going to be a role model to most of the other societies of our federation. I'm just hoping that every one of us working towards the women's cause will be able to have a more gender neutral society in our country. Well, friends, no to violence against women. The Dira experience, we thought we'll just discuss on the effect on women's health. Dira means courage. Dira is an initiative which says stop violence against women. When we think about history, mythology, what has changed from the times of Mahabharata to the Hathras and the incidents now? Nothing much has changed. So over the decades where the woman's modesty was actually put to stake is in something which is unfortunate. And it's something that we need to put a stop to. And when you look at the state-wise rise in the rape cases over the past few years, where are we actually heading to? I thought as a young girl that as we are becoming more modern, as we become more advanced, we'll be actually moving to a more safer place for all the people to live with. But unfortunately, we find there's so many unsafe spaces and some cities which are supposed to be the best. You know, I can never digest the fact that Delhi, our own capital, is one of the unsafe spaces. And this is the situation of our country. And the same so is the situation across the globe in so many other places. Now, why do we need to talk about the violence against women? Because it intersects with the health issues in women. We need to see, we need to focus on the impact of war during pregnancy and our role as obstetrician gynecologists in detecting war and the role of our trainees to focus on violence against women as the future torchbearers of women's health. We all now understand that preventive care is much better than trying to do a curative care. It was way back actually into the early 2007-8 onwards, where, you know, suddenly we found the girl-child ratio was actually dwindling. And our state also was seeing where there was a reduction in the girl-child ratio. So we were doing a lot of girl-child saving programs. And in 2013, when I did the first FOCSI FIGO conference, we initiated the Save the Girl-Child movement. It was, this little girl says, invest in me, I'm the future. To create an awareness in the society about the importance of the girl child. Friends, in this actually we had our girl child as the ambassador, Ms. Sindhu, who actually later on went on to become twice the Olympic champion. Violence against women is perhaps the most shameful human rights violation, and it's perhaps the most pervasive. It knows no boundaries of geography, culture, wealth. As long as it continues, we cannot claim to be making real progress towards equality, development, and peace. Said by Kofi Annan, I would have told this dialogue, I think, hundreds of times. But unfortunately, still, we are not finding where the end of this particular seed is going to be. We need to understand that any behavior which is causing not only physical, but sexual, psychological, and reproductive coercion, and forcing a woman to live in fear is the violence. And when you look at the UN report way back in 95, it's the same so even now. Forced pregnancy, forced abortion, forced sterilization, or denial of family planning are all forms of violence. Who is going to decide about how many children the woman is going to have, when she wants to go and have a child, when she will decide that she wouldn't like to carry the baby and she would like to have an abortion? Those are the sexual and reproductive rights of the woman. It is not the husband, it's not the family, it's not the government who is going to decide. I think that is very vital. And Indian data actually shows that reproductive coercion exists in about 22% to 50%. It looks like reproductive coercion is a norm rather than exception. And friends, it has an impact on the global burden of diseases. And WHO has said that 35% of women were affected by violence at the hands of their partners. And Southeast Asia, 38%. Globally, at least once in a lifetime, 69% of women are reporting physical abuse. And friends, between 7 and 48% of girls and young women aged 10 to 24 years report the first sexual intercourse encounter as coerced. And what was true in 2002 is the same with the study by Garcia again in 2012. Our Indian statistics are nothing much to boast about. Crime against women, 1 in 3 minutes. 1 rape every 29 minutes. 1 dowry death still in these days. Cruelty by the husband. Patriarchal terrorism, so many things. And friends, rural women more affected. India has the highest rate of violence during pregnancy. Look at this map, but one thing is that this global prevalence of intimate partner violence has no global boundaries. It is there in every nook and corner of the world, be it the most advanced North America who think that they are the global leaders, to the Latin American, to the Europeans, to the Middle East, African and Asia, to Australia, everywhere it is there. And this particular slide shows the map that where India is also among the top 15, but all for the wrong reasons. And when you look at this small graph, the intimate partner violence is almost 41%. So many simple reasons, honor killing in these days. These are all the types of things which we are seeing in the paper. What is it that we are able to do for this? And look at this. Different types of injuries women face. And we find that it's omnipotent, men and women inequality. We have to endow them with the same dignity. Reasons, arguing with him, going out without telling him, neglecting the children, refusing to cook or burning the food are some of the reasons. Just see the point which the woman is subjected to a violence. Unfortunately, women are at a greater risk of domestic violence. And the silent pandemic, as it is termed, has increased during a pandemic, especially during the COVID. There have been horrifying global surge in domestic violence. Since the start of COVID-19 lockdowns, said UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres in early April. Malaysia, for example, reported 57% more domestic call helplines, and so was our country. The shadow pandemic. The shadow pandemic violence against women and girls and COVID-19, we found that this has become at par with the COVID pandemic. My own state, I'm very proud of my state, Telangana, but unfortunately, look at the status of my state also. The prevalence has shown that 43% of women experience spousal violence and 5.9% experience violence during pregnancy. So to be born as a girl discriminated from womb to tomb, in the face, pre-birth to the type of violence, sex selective abortion, effect of battering on the pregnancy and childbirth, to domestic violence and female violence, right from the infanticide to genital mutilation to the psychological abuse, incest, child prostitution, pornography. Adolescent age group, dating, courtship violence, cyber violence, these are all trafficking of women. Partner violence. These are the things that forced pregnancies. That's where we come into the picture. So friends, we have to see where these different forms interact with each other. We see a lot of cases in our OPD or in the ER, violence in pregnancy. Near miss mortality, brutal violence causing antepartum hemorrhage. The patient may come to you with antepartum hemorrhage, shock, placenta accreta, but see what is there behind it. The vulval hematomas. This is for not willing for sexual by the partner. There's a hidden violence masquerading as a maternal disorder. You may actually write the reason for the death as a death due to eclampsia. But actually, when you delve into the history, we see there's a direct death due to violence. So rupture of the uterus, shock. Later you find that it was a brutal killing by the husband who pushed the woman and she fell on a sharp edge. So friends, when we actually did the study of effect of the intimate partner violence on pregnancy outcome in a public care facility hospital, and we found we in Hyderabad are also no less to any other city, even in this violence against women. 38% of incidents, which is very, very sad. So we have to make sure that there are problems and look at the physical health markers. If she may be coming to you frequently with only pain or dysuria, UTI or wide discharge, on examination you may find nothing, or she may be in fear and shock, denial, all of this. So you go into the history, be a source of where they will be able to actually divulge their problems with you. So violence and women's health, where do they intersect? Women are not dying because of the disease we cannot treat. They're dying because societies have yet to make decisions that their lives are worth saving. Mohammed Fatala, our president, we go way back in 97. So for the empowerment of women, we're promoting gender equity, SDG 5, to promote, improve economic independence and education for women, to stay committed to shape the future of women, family and nation. Friends, the goal is to work for the dignity, freedom, and ensure women's participation at all levels of decision-making in the society. Stop violence against women. Alert women from all exploitative compensation. Sensitizing and creating an awareness from the ages they connect themselves to the society. So you be the voice, the advocacy. And that's why we need to even catch all of the trainees, because they are the future of our country. The global maternity rate we see, and we have seen that this maternal mortality and morbidity has an impact on the economy of the country, and violence actually contributes to it. So many delays, everything, but then we have to see what is behind these causes. So that is the reason we say be alert to the intimate partner violence. So this contributes to maternal mortality rate. You cannot talk about HIV and AIDS without talking about domestic and sexual violence. Men refuse to use condoms, and this leads to the increase in the HIV transmission. And it is a human rights violation, a major public health problem. And violence in pregnancy by intimate partner is also widely prevalent. We know that this war is recognized as a public health problem, human rights violation of worldwide significance. And friends, we have seen in our own world now, we have been talking about Afghanistan. We have seen how women's rights, the security, safety of the women is put to so much of risk. And what is it that we are doing? We say we are advanced. We have so much of connectivity. We have the global leaders. We have got the global world who is going to take care of everyone. But there, where is the global voice that we can say no to this sort of barbaric action against our own women? They may be in a different country. But so this is where each one of us have to actually talk about it. And Figu, when in 2015, this working group on violence against women was started, and I became a member of this group, that time we really didn't know what to do. And we used to have meetings and were wondering how we will make a change. Then we realized that. Then I thought about it and I said, we obstetrician gynecologists are a specialist stakeholder in women's health, because we have to assess and provide support to women who experience violence because of the nature of the patient-physician relationship. So that's where we conceived this initiative of Dheera, No to Violence Against Women. Dheera, which means courage, conviction, strength, to sensitize self-fraternity, victims, male partners, and people at large. Advocacy, giving a call, making a noise, sounding a warning that war has to stop. Focus on the action, bring in all the stakeholders together. And that is what is needed. So we started this Dheera initiative first, where we flagged it off in the first conference, and we brought the police, the National Commission for Women, the celebrities, the press, media, men and women to come together and raise the voice, give the advocacy that we need to say no to violence against women. Friends, giving this call was very important. When we start talking about it, then at least the perpetrators are a bit worried that everyone is talking about it, so they will be a little wary. And the social media, the press have a great responsibility to actually make them more sensitive. We have to involve the celebrity. I wouldn't have liked to have a celebrity, but then we know how the press will react. They will be there only if there is an Amitabh Bachchan or a Samantha or an Aishwarya Rai. They will not be there if Kunju Mohideen or Shanta Kumari or Fessy are there. That's the reason why we needed to have celebrities, so that these celebrities will attract the press, and that will make this advocacy of ours be taken across to the public. So UN has identified orange color to say no to war, and wear orange and say no to violence against women. So that was the scene where we saw the atmosphere was yellow and the mood was upbeat, and we realized that this passion is something which will actually make us all work towards trying to see how we can help our women. Then we focused on the cyclothons, bikeathons, rallies, adolescent health camps, talks and interactive sessions at colleges and radio programs. So we continued the march. In 2017, we had the whole FIGO leadership. We did the Foxy FIGO second conference in Hyderabad. And that time, President C.N. Purandare and President-elect Carlos were there. We said men need to partner gender equity. And this flash mob by the students and raising the voice for Dheera, partnering with men to stop violence against women. Reproductive coercion and norm rather than an exception is something which we need to look into. At the time, FIGO was very impressed and they said, we need you to take your committee activities globally. And in fact, I was invited to the FLASOC conference, the Latin American Federation Congress. They have one Congress once in 3 years. And we had the No to War press meet where all the men were there, but they were talking about women's health. And we put our foot down and said, we need to also give our opinion. And then we actually gave the statement on the responsibility and role of OB-GYNs. Diana was there, Desri, all of us. Of course, I spoke in English and they had a Spanish translator. And today also, I wish I had got that paper to know exactly what they have translated. And this in FIGO participation was at the insistence of us to show that we care. And then we had the FIGO Congress in 2018. The declaration was signed by FIGO, UNFPA, WHO, and member countries to stop violence against women. We took this Dheera. FIGO leadership wanted me today to take this Dheera to Rio, the FIGO Congress. Again, we faced a lot of difficulties from that government. And they said, local organizers said, no, the government will not agree. They will not allow us to do this. Then FIGO had to put the foot down. And I and the CEO and the president, we put our foot down. We said, this is our Congress. We are not bothered about your local political interests. Our Congress, the whole globally, everyone is looking at FIGO. What we are going to say, because we are the global voice for women's health. And we are going to tell what exactly we are meaning. And we took this global march ahead. And I was very happy to say globally, all the societies came together and participated. And the message was loud and clear that OB-GYNs, FIGO says, stop violence against women, no to violence against women. You know, at that time, I still remember we had this orange t-shirts. I had actually bought so many 300, 500 orange t-shirts in Hyderabad, and we couldn't carry them. So we couriered them to Brazil. We thought we'll pick them up at the airport, but they were confiscated at the customs and they didn't give us. And then finally, you know, they asked us such a huge amount of money, some $10,000 for those t-shirts. And we said, no, that is because they wanted to arm twist us. We went ahead and did this march with all the local, we made this all this flags and all then and there, and then got this Dheera march successfully. So friends, every one of us are committed in this Dheera Stop Violence Against Women. Foxy has actually partnered with each other. And last year before the COVID, we did in the ISAR 2020, the Dheera initiative, because we have seen the harsh reality rise in domestic violence and the examples of best practices. Now, pharmacy and supermarkets in France and Spain have actually put up place emergency warning system to provide counseling services to victims for gender-based violence. These, especially in some of the countries, they've actually identified some hotel rooms where women could go and stay because the lockdown, they were being exposed to the violence against them by the perpetrators. So role of the healthcare system's recommendations, if you are experiencing violence during COVID, reach out, call and seek out. These are all some of the simple postures which you can put up in your OPD. Friends, Dheera means courage, the courage, the power of being Dheera together. This year, Foxy is rolling out this initiative, Dheera Stop Violence Against Women, the Dheera Online School Certification Program. I need the support of all the presidents and secretaries and all the members of our federation. We're going to launch this in collaboration with UNICEF. We're going to train the master trainers from all the different societies. Next week, we'll have a meeting with the President Secretary. This online, simple online school certification program to target the young boys and girls of 9th and 10th class. Talk to them about this violence. Tell them about the impact the violence has on the health of women. This will go ahead to make them more gender sensitive. They will grow up to be more gender sensitive if the girls have seen the mother being affected. And they should not grow up thinking it's okay to get be abused. And the boys, if they have seen somebody abuse women, they should not grow up and say, okay, it's okay for me to behave like that. So we have to catch them young. That is why this structured program, I hope, will actually enable the future generation to say no to war. And the end of this, the government, the Ministry of Health, and everyone should come across and make this mandatory, compulsory in the curriculum. So we will be looking for support from all the societies to take this program to the schools in your area. The second pillar, CME workshops and CME for gynecologists to build capacities and sensors. Our own healthcare providers, we are going to start as soon as things become a little better. And this is where we can see how, what is the women's health and war, sexual aspects, rehabilitation of survivor, how to create a war-free communities. So friends, violence against women has to be detected in pregnancy. And as obstetricians and gynecologists, we play a pivotal role. And we have a responsibility in trying to be their voice and screen for violence at every opportunity, providing healthcare and other possible help and support. This will have a far-reaching implication on women's health and maternal mortality rate. The journey of Dheera never ends. The courage should never end. So women should have the courage to say no to violence against women. So thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, ma'am, for that wonderful lecture. I would like to invite Dr. Mitra, ma'am, to read out the oration scroll. Share.
Thank you. I will be doing this great honor to read the oration scroll. But before that,
please,
I will
share,
just take
the scroll.
Yeah, while the IT team, support team will put that up. I take this opportunity to really express my deep admiration for this very sensitive, compassionate, empowered, and a focused obstetrician of our country, who is also donning the cap and hat of our President Foxy. And it is a proud moment for me, given by Dr. Kunju, to chair her oration, which is actually giving me goose flesh. And friends, when you walk the talk, you make the biggest impact. So locally, nationally, and now internationally, Dr. Shanta Kumari has made this a mission, and which every one of us and all the women, all the obstetricians, how it is very, very important. And I'm so thankful that I've heard it from such close quarters. Thank you, ma'am. And now we take pride in announcing this scroll. The annual conference of Perinatalamana Obstetrics and Gynecological Society under aegis of Practical Obstetrics Committee, FOXI, which is just not just a webinar, but a complete virtual experience. FOXI President's Oration 2021 has been conferred on Professor S. Shanta Kumari, India, President of FOXI 2021, for the topic Dheera, Stop Violence Against Women during NOESIS 2.0, held on 11 September 2021 on virtual reality platform. By bestowing this oration on her, we acknowledge not only her continued contribution to the field of obstetrics and gynecology, but also for being a beacon of light for members of varied generations to explore, comprehend, and dedicate the discoveries for overall patient care. Wishing her many, many more years of academic excellence. And of course, we really wish, madam, that you should take this to the international platform. Thank you so much. Signed by Dr. Kunju Muhyiddin, President, and Dr. Abdul Wahab, Secretary of POGS. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those kind words. Thank you, Kunju Muhyiddin and Wahab and all of you, Mitra and everyone.
We'll come to Hyderabad and hand over the oration plaque. And
you're welcome.
Thank you, ma'am.